information, but let me go ahead and get started. Let me before I start preaching, let me just take a minute and just tell you a little bit about what's going on. On Sunday, we're going to be doing our 21 days of prayer and fasting. We'll have paper on the walls. We'll have rocks for lost ones. We're going to have different prayer stations. In Sunday morning service, we've got something we're going to do. We're going to take 5 minutes in the middle of service for us to have time to go write stuff on the board, pray over stuff that's on the board, write some rocks. We're going to take some time in the service. We're going to do some group prayer together. And then like next Wednesday night, Cindy's going to be leading. She's going to be teaching next Wednesday night, so she'll have a time in prayer. So in all of our services, we're not going to just be teaching, but we're also going to be demonstrating prayer. But also, on Wednesday nights for the first quarter at least, we are going to be teaching on the Holy Spirit. We really feel like that this is a season, and I'm going to tell you a little bit of why, but we really feel like it's a season that we need to talk a lot about the Holy Spirit. Not a little bit about the Holy Spirit, but a lot about the Holy Spirit. And so when we sat down, when the preaching team sat down for Wednesday night and started looking at what we're going to talk about, Cindy was supposed to go first and talk about who is the Holy Spirit. Then I was going to come the next week and fill in anything that I felt like she didn't cover, that I wanted to cover. I'm the more experienced preacher, so I was going to go second. And then we realized that I'm not going to be here next Wednesday night, so I have to go first. So somehow I have to stay away from what she's going to talk about next week. And at the same time, both of us cover it, but it's okay if you hear something more than once. Is that right? Okay. So I'm going to talk about who the Holy Spirit as a person is, and then she's going to talk about the same thing. And then the third Wednesday night, Dr. Harvey is going to speak on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He's going to talk about what it was like for him to be a Baptist pastor and then to experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In fact, our youth are going to cancel youth back there. The youth are going to be over here that Wednesday night. The youth are going to be leading worship 2 Wednesday nights from now. And they're going to be in here when Dr. Harvey's here, and he's going to preach on baptism of the Holy Spirit. Coming out of that, then, Chip and Robbie, on 2 different Wednesday nights, are going to talk about John 20, I think it's John 20, 2021. And John 20, 21, when Jesus breathed the Holy Spirit on the disciples after the resurrection, but before his ascension. And what that means, and both of them fought over who got to preach that, and so we said, well, both of you can, back to back, and we'll just see how your different experiences, pre-Pentecost, but after the resurrection. And then we're going to talk about the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And so tonight, I'm just going to lay some foundation. Hey, if you need, raise your hands again, Holy Ghost people. Tonight, I'm just going to lay some foundations. And I'm going to leave us some room to ask some questions or maybe wrestle through. We're a church that feels very comfortable with disagreement and talking through stuff in a godly way. And just sort of helping to flesh out exactly what it is that we believe. Now, before I get into this, I need to ask you an important question. Well, I got to wait till the ushers get done because I'm going to make you vote. So let me just go ahead and pray. I'll pray. Is that good? Pray is not filler, but it's always a good place to start. All right? So, Lord, right now we come before you and we ask that you'd open our eyes and our ears to the things that you would like to share with us tonight. Each of us right now take our filters in our hands and we pull them down a wee bit that we might be open to revelation we've never considered before, to understanding we've never had. We ask, God, that you would lead us and guide us and that we would walk into deeper waters than we've ever walked in before. And we ask that we be very comfortable with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And we ask, Lord, we were reminded that in the Scripture of the parable of the word, of the sower, that, Lord, the seed did not have a problem. It was the condition of the ground. So right now, till up the condition of our hearts that we can receive whatever it is that you'd have us to receive. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, let me just start here real quick. How many of you guys have ever prayed before? Raise your hand. All right. How many of you all have ever prayed specifically to God the Father? How many of you all have ever prayed to Jesus? Oh, Jesus, help me. How many of you all have specifically said, Holy Spirit, I pray to you right now. Lift your hand. You notice the numbers go down, though. The numbers go down when we start talking about the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to take some time tonight. I'm going to walk through some thoughts and ideas. We're going to start publishing the Wednesday night because of this, the Holy Spirit. We're going to publish the Wednesday night videos so you can go back and watch them as well. So let's have a little bit of fun. Let's talk some things too. Number one, who is the Holy Spirit? He is a partner. Okay, I've got four parts I'm going to mention. He is a partner, he's a person, he has a position, and he has a purpose. That's the four things I'm hitting tonight. He is a partner. He's part of the Trinity. Now let's pull up Genesis 1, 1 through 3, because this is the first part time we see the Godhead all working together. And it says here that in the beginning, God, that word there for God is Elohim. Elohim. In the Hebrew, when you see a word that ends in I-M, seraphim, it means plural. So Elohim is plural for God. Seraphim means plural. So in the beginning, the plural God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." Can we go back to verse 2 again? You'll notice I used orange just as the Spirit of God hovering. I used that color there for a second, the Spirit of God. Then go to verse 3. And then I said, "Then God said, let there be light." And I used blue and I used green. I used two different colors. We know that the Bible says in John 1:1 and 1 John 1, it says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God. Through it, all things were created. So here we have our first picture that helps us understand who the Holy Spirit is. We tend to think of God. Give me some names, some names for God or some pictures of who God the Father is. Okay, tell me a little bit about God. He's a Father. Okay, we know what that looks like. Where we get our identity from, our Father, so we get our shield. What? Healer, Lion of the Tribe of Judah. Now, Lion of the Tribe of Judah talks about Jesus. It's not talking about God the Father. See, that we have identity crisis. No, I'm serious. That's what happens. We just lump God all together, and I'm trying to be very specific in this to separate who the Holy Spirit is separate. But the Lion of the Tribe of Judah is not the Holy Spirit. That is Jesus, the Son of God. Okay? Who else is God? He's Yahweh, Jehovah, but he's God the Creator. We see him as the master gardener. Do we not see him as the one who creates the earth and oversees all of creation, and all things are in his hands? He's the God the Father, the master gardener. He's in charge. He's our provider. He takes care of us. You know, and that's God. And sometimes when we pray, and specifically if our prayer request is directed in one of those needs, we call upon God the Father, right? And then tell me a little about Jesus the Son. Redeemer. The bridegroom. Thank you. I'm sorry. You all were like, you have Jesus down pat. And I will say that most Christians do, especially here in the South where we preach a very evangelical word. We're very comfortable with Jesus. Thank God for our Baptist brethren. We're going to hear about Jesus. We're going to get saved. All right? So you said the bridegroom, and you said the Lamb of God, the Lion, our great high priest. We got Jesus down pat. Now, when we get to heaven, we'll figure out we don't have Jesus down pat, but we have him more down pat than we have the other. Now, tell me a little bit about the Holy Spirit. Comforter, counselor, teacher, helper, power, intercessor. What? Say again. Calms us down. We need you, Holy Ghost. Help us, Holy Ghost. Yep. Who else? Huh? Very good. Our conscience convicts us. Power. Okay. So it was very interesting. You used the word teacher for the Holy Spirit. Nobody said word for Jesus, which is interesting. All right. So let's go back for just a second, and we look at Genesis chapter 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Verse 2. The earth was without form and void, and darkness on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And then God said, "Let there be light." Okay, so what we see here, and there's several places throughout the Scriptures where we see the Trinity working together, and this is one of the places. So we see God the Father as this master gardener. It's God the Father who speaks, and God said. It's God the Father who speaks. It's God the Father who gives identity. Fathers give identity. Fathers have authority. So God the Father, we feel that. We sense that. That feels good. The Bible says then that all things were created through Jesus. And says in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All right, this is why I get frustrated with people who try to make the Bible the fourth part of the Trinity. The Bible is the holy Word of God, the inerrant Word of God, the perfect Word of God. I have the greatest respect for the Word of God. I don't take anything away from the Word of God. But there is more to the Word of God than the Word of God. Because this is the holy inspired scripture of God, but this is but a shadow of what the real Word of God is, which is a person, which is Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that if we tried to write a book that captured everything that the Word of God said and did on the earth, the world could not contain the volumes of it. So sometimes we try to take the Word and bring it only to what is between this leather shell, and the Word of God is way beyond this leather shell. Now, any word that God speaks or does will always resonate and confirm this word, but, you know, it'll never, you know, disagree with this word, but the Word of God is so much bigger. And so sometimes I'll hear some of my pastor friends say, we don't need God to speak today. We have the Word. Well, this Bible doesn't tell me who to marry. Doesn't tell me what job to take. It doesn't tell me what decisions to make today. It doesn't tell me who in the store to stop and witness to today. So it's important that we understand that the Word of God is way bigger than this. I love this book. I would even say, I would challenge you all to love it as much as I love this book. But I love the Word of Jesus more than I love the Word of this book. Does that make sense? All right, so in the beginning was the Word, and it was the Word that was spoken. All right? Then we notice that verse 2, it says the Spirit of God was hovering. He was brooding. The Holy Spirit was there preparing the atmosphere for things to come to life. God the Father has it in his head to create this earth, to create mankind. Why? Because God is love, and love must express itself. So God is so full of love, he has to have something to share that love with. So he creates something that he can shower his love on, and that's why we're here. I wish that Christians could get your number one job on this planet is to be loved. You are the beloved of the Lord. He created you to experience his satisfaction, his joy, and his love. Not to do something for him, but to be with him and let experience his love and his goodness. So here's God. He decides to create the earth, decides to create all these people. And as he does that, the way he creates is he speaks the Word, Jesus, the Word. But before the Word comes forward, it says that the Spirit of God was hovering over the earth. So here's the Holy Spirit. He's just getting, he gets us fertile. He gets us fertile. The Holy Spirit's job is to prepare the elements for the Word of God to make us pregnant. So the Holy Spirit is tilling up the ground. He's making us fertile. He's getting us to a place where we could receive the Word so we can become pregnant. And that's the job of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit does not respond to anything but God's Word. He only, listen, Jesus didn't do anything that he didn't hear the Father say or see the Father do. The Holy Spirit is just as equally submitted as Jesus is submitted, and the Holy Spirit has the power to make any dead thing fertile for a Word of God, but he only responds to a Word of God. So when God the Father says, let there be light, there was never in any question whether there was going to be light. Why? Because the Word has power. The Holy Spirit set up the atmosphere to receive the Word of God. God spoke the Word of God, and everything in creation moved for there to be light. Now the issue is, now let me just do a little test here. Do we have the power to speak the Word of God? Yes. And that's one of the great deficits in the body of Christ, is us discerning what God the Father wants to create and speaking the Word of God under the environment that is fertile by the Spirit of God and seeing the Word come to life, and that's our job. The Holy Spirit responds to the Word of God, whether it was spoke by God or spoke by God through Mike Dedeker and spoke on the earth. But that's our job, and that's why we got to be so careful in how we use the words, because in our words is the power of life and death. All right, so just a minute. Let's fast forward for a second. Angel shows up, says, Mary, you wonderful woman, you blessed of the Lord. You're going to get pregnant. You're going to have the Savior. How can this be? And he says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's going to cause you, now forgive me, but we're a Wednesday night crowd here and we're mature Christians, right? The Holy Spirit is going to make you ovulate. He's going to bring you into a position to where you're fertile, to where the Word of God can lodge inside your spirit and you can become pregnant. It's the job of the Holy Spirit to do that inner work inside of us to prepare us and be ready to receive the Word of God. And that's the job. Now, I've never preached that, and I wouldn't preach it on Sunday morning. I have ovulated before. I'm in a very ovulated season right now, where I'm fertile right now, waiting on a now word from God to birth something for the kingdom. There's been other seasons when I was dry as bones. I didn't have any. I was not pregnant. I wasn't fertile. I wasn't ovulated. So that we can all understand, that's the job of the Holy Spirit, is to bring us to that place of ovulation, a place of fertility, that place where the ground is tilled up, where the seed can come and the seed can land, and then the Word can produce what God wanted to produce. And that's one of the jobs of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit when a lost person begins to hear the gospel. And suddenly the Holy Spirit begins to brood over them. And suddenly it stirs the water. And suddenly that word they've heard before by other preachers on TV and other circumstances that missed its target, suddenly now they are wide open, their spirits are fertile, and now suddenly that word that's been spoken numerous times, suddenly it applies to them, and suddenly their spirit opens up, and God puts the Word of God in their heart and their life, and they're able for the first time ever to recognize they're a sinful person with no hope, and they begin to recognize who Jesus Christ, the Word of God, is, and they take hold of it, and they pull it into their heart, and new life happens in their spirit. That's the job of the Holy Spirit. I would say to you, in the late great revival, I believe we need the Holy Spirit now more than we ever need the Holy Spirit. We need him brooding. Do lost people need the Holy Spirit brooding over their life? Yes. Do saved people need the Holy Spirit brooding? We need the Holy Spirit brooding over our houses, over our land, over our hearts, over our lives. So what we see is we see the Godhead working together. I've got some work to do. Okay, 1 John. Pull up 1 John 5 real quick. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. Keep going. 7. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. I find it interesting that we say the Holy Spirit is the teacher, but Jesus is the Word. Jesus is the Word that produces life, but it is the teacher that helps us understand and how to apply the Word to our lives. He is the great teacher, the great instructor on what to do with the Word of God. The two go hand in hand. You can't have a teacher without pupils. You can't have pupils without teachers. Well, you got a teacher, but you got a Word. And so he is the great teacher, and these three bear witness to one another. Is God the Father God? Yes. Is God the Son, Jesus Christ, God? Yes. Is God the Spirit, God? Yes. All three, equally God, three different expressions of one God, three in one. The word Trinity means three in one, three in one. So I was on the internet, as people are wont to do when we're going to teach something. This is not original with me, but I thought it was brilliant. Some of y'all may have seen it. I had never seen it. I thought this was brilliant. The Trinity is represented in math terms. He is not 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 3. He is 1 times 1 times 1 equals 1. Isn't that brilliant? That's how he's not three different people. He's three different expressions, personalities of the same person. But he's one God. He's three in one. So let me just ask you a question. You're made up of, we live in a three-dimensional world, right? Height, width, depth, we got dimensions, right? Well, he's God the Father. He doesn't live within our confines, but the same sort of thing. There are three parts of the Trinity. We were made in his image, body, soul, and spirit, right?
All right.
If you have an intimate relationship with your spouse, but you only have relationship in two of those three areas, is it not wanting in your relationship? If you have a spouse, but you're never physical with your spouse, isn't something lacking in your relationship with one another? Or if you have a physical relationship and you have a spiritual relationship, but you never connect emotionally in any way, isn't something wrong? Isn't something? Or even if you have a physical and an emotional relationship, but one of you is saved and the other's not saved, and you have no spiritual relationship, isn't something lacking, missing? Isn't it? And in the church, we have a relationship with God the Father. We have a relationship with God the Son. But we're so lacking in the relationship with God the Holy Spirit. And for him to be, Jesus to be the bridegroom, and for us to be the bride, there needs to be an intimate relationship with all three. And somehow, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit can equally submit one to another out of love and reverence for one another, that they never take away from each other, they only add to one another. And then Jesus says, Father, let them be one as we're one. What? I don't have a relationship with two other people where we're mutually submissive to one another. And every action we do is to promote the others before ourselves in such a way that we never take, but we only give. But that's what Jesus prayed for us. And that's the example we have. Equal submission among the Godhead, where Jesus never does the job of the Father because he knows the Father will do his job. In fact, the Father can do his job better than anybody can do his job. So why would Jesus try to do his job? And the Holy Spirit always does his job because he can do the job better than anybody else. So Jesus never tries to do the Holy Spirit's job. Yet we try to do the Holy Spirit's job for our grown kids or as preachers for our congregation. Now listen, I'm serious. They have such mutual respect for one another, they never do each other's job. They trust each other to do their own job, and therefore, they always plus, never subtract. Isn't that amazing? Now, can I ask you a question? I'm nowhere near my notes. So let me ask you a question. God the Father, does he speak? Yes. Jesus, does he speak? Holy Spirit, does he speak? Well, in Acts 2, he's like the tongues of fire. I mean, if that's not a description. Okay, so let's go back, because this is interesting. All right, so Melchizedek. Now, we're not going to stay there long. We're going to stay here for about 30 seconds. 30 seconds, we're not going to get in a big fight of who Melchizedek is. We've done that. I won. We're not going to do that. Just kidding. I think we called it an 8-way draw that night. Okay, So some people believe that Melchizedek was a Christophany, Christ in the Old Testament, Christophany, that he showed up because he had no father, mother, no beginning and end, and, you know, high priest, all that, Christophany. Other scholars will call that a theophany. They'll call it God in the Old Testament showed up. It was God who shows up, theophany, Christophany. But they never talk about the spirophany. The spirit-ophany. So whenever God shows up, whenever we see a picture of God in the Old Testament, they either call it a Christophany or a Theophany. They never call it a Spiritophany, if that's even a word. And if it's not, I'd like to coin it tonight. You can't have it. I want to use it. All right, so is there ever a time in the Old Testament that God showed up that might have been the Holy Spirit and it might not have been Jesus or God? I mean, is there ever one example where we would say, that looks a lot more like the Holy Spirit than God the Father or God the Son? I mean, Melchizedek was a priest and Jesus is our priest, so I can see why you would think it was a Christophany. Where? Burning bush. That's very interesting. I always just gave credit to God the Father, Theophany, on that. What else? No, I wasn't thinking talking donkey. I was thinking the three Hebrew children in the fire. Because the Holy Spirit is known as wind or water or fire. And I was thinking, he says he looked down. Never do we see Jesus in fire. I mean, that's not Jesus' personality. But we see the three Hebrew children, and it says the fourth was like the Son of God. What? You think so because Son of God? That was said with authority. I personally believe that the Lord can send fire down and it not be the Holy Ghost. Personally. I like the reference to Revelation and feet burning fire. I like that. Go ahead. The pillar of fire. I think that's interesting. That pillar of fire that guides us and leads us, because that's the Holy Spirit. Pillar of fire. That's pretty interesting. What I'm trying to say is that scholars feel way more comfortable talking about Jesus showing up in the Old Testament or God the Father showing up in the Old Testament than talking about the Holy Spirit showing up in the Old Testament. But I think if we look at the characteristics of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, there are several places in the Old Testament where you'd probably say, well, that was God the Holy Spirit showing up in the Old Testament. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, of course, we know at Jesus' baptism, there's Jesus in a physical body being baptized. And then as he's baptized, the dove comes down to come and dwell upon him, dwell within him. And at the same time, God the Father speaks, this is my beloved Son whom I'm well pleased. So we see the Trinity working together at that place. So he is a partner. He is part of the Trinity, equally submitted, but equally God in every way. And I really like the 1 × 1 × 1 = 3. I'm sorry, equals 1. Sorry. Point number 2, he's a person. And Elder Dedeker gave us some notes tonight that talked about that he is a person. I gave my notes away. Yeah, I've got some. That he is a person. And I'm not going to go through and read all this, but it talks about the fact that he has an intellect and he has a knowledge. There, he has emotions. Isn't that wild? That we're dealing with a God who has emotions, can be grieved, can be offended, that we can squelch the Holy Spirit, that we can shut down the Holy Spirit and say, I'm just not interested. And it can you imagine, thank you, Jimmy, you're an excellent, excellent man, that the Holy Spirit never uses manipulation or compulsion, makes himself available, and then we get to choose yes or we get to say no. Has any of you ever been in a circumstance where you felt the Holy Spirit and he was very clear on what he desired next, and you did something opposite, and you quenched him, and you felt his grief? I have, and I felt his grief. I mean, felt the pain and the grief of grieving the Holy Spirit. So in my notes, here's what I just said, a couple of things. I said he is a person. I said, one, that he's not a created being. When we look in heaven, or we look in the scriptures, to our knowledge, we have the Godhead, we have angels, we have created beings, and we have people. That's what we know of those four for sure. We don't know if there's Martians. We don't know what else is out there. But when we look in the books of the Bible, we see God, the Godhead, which is eternal, which has always existed. Then we see the things that were created, and there are angels created. Then there's saying we call them creative beings. They're sort of angels, but they're sort of different than angels, and they're very specific in what they do. And they're just creative beings, and they're weird, and they're way out there. And then there's us. There's humans, and even those of us that are in heaven are the cloud of witnesses. But we're all created beings. They're all created by God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not a created being. The Holy Spirit is not an angel. The Holy Spirit is not an it. And that becomes one of the big issues with people with the Holy Spirit. For instance, somebody asked me, it was either Chip, Mike Dietrich, or Julie. I don't remember which one of y'all asked me. Said, have you ever seen the Holy Spirit? Which one of y'all asked me that question? Julie did. All right. So Julie asked me the question. She said, have you ever seen the Holy Spirit? And I said, and she backed up and she said, well, when you pray to God the Father, do you ever see God the Father? I don't know that I have seen God the Father, but when I pray to God the Father, an image comes to my mind, usually of a large throne, not specific details of a face or figure, but I see God the Father ruling and reigning. Not every time I pray, but there are times when I'm praying, this mental image comes up, whether it comes out of my spirit or comes out of heaven, I don't know. But I've had other visions, but on this one, it's just like, hey, you are God the Father. And then, you know, have you ever seen Jesus when you pray? And yes, there's a mental image that comes of a whitish, Middle Eastern, long-haired guy, radiant, post-ascension, glorified body, authority, power, gentle, loving. It's mine. I'm sure when I get to heaven, God will say, doesn't look anything like that. I don't know, but it's my vision, my picture. She says, have you ever seen the Holy Spirit when you pray? Do you ever have? I was like, no, I have not. And I'm one of those pastors that's willing to say, I'm still on a journey. No, I have not got a vision of the Holy Spirit. And so, why not? And I'm like, that's a great question. Do you ever pray to the Holy Spirit? Yes, I pray to the Holy Spirit. Usually when I'm thinking Holy Spirit stuff, I pray to the Holy Spirit. And you're like, but you don't see the Holy Spirit? Not to go into a long stuff and not to unpack it, but recently I had an experience where I was praying. And suddenly, I felt like I saw an image of the Holy Spirit, which was of fire, a large fire, bigger than me kind of fire. And suddenly, I'm like, wow, I don't know whether the Holy Spirit is more like a breeze, you know, more like a wind, you know. What do you mean? So Ernie says presence and or a feeling around you. I've heard people say that they felt like a breath of air rushed by them, and they was like the Holy Spirit. You know, Holy Spirit is symbolized by water or by wind or by fire. For me, whatever reason, the only time I have ever prayed that I've ever had any mental image of the Holy Spirit was in the last couple weeks, and it was a fire. And I don't know if. And the way he shows himself to me may be different than the way he shows to you. But what? The Holy Spirit looks like her? Oh. And what was it like for you? Smoke. Interesting. Okay, my fire had eyes. I was going to say it out loud. I honestly wasn't. I was not going to say it. But there are people in this room that I've told that to that know I'm not making that up, that it had eyes. And so that was very interesting. Right here, girl. Right here. See, as a pastor, I was going to give enough food that they didn't choke tonight. I wasn't going to go all the way on the fire with the eyes that I recently, but Kristen can vouch for it. I talked to her about it last week, and then you said the eyes. I just had to confess. Okay. It's not an it. It's person. He's a person. The Holy Spirit is a person. And I think that if we're going to relate to the Holy Spirit, we can't think of him as this external force that's a angel or created being or something. But he's a person. He has a personality. He has emotions. He has knowledge. He has intellect. He has preferences. And we've got to recognize those things. So we got to be very careful. And one of the reasons we struggle with that is because if I say to you, God the Father, you think of a fatherly figure. We were used to fathers. If I say to God the Son, you're like, we know what sons are like. But if I say God the Holy Spirit, you're like, that's nebulous. What does God the Holy Spirit, give me a form for that. Well, that's the problem. He's formless. He's Holy Spirit, right? All right. Persons have personalities, and he's a spirit. And because we are primarily aware of our physical surroundings, we struggle with the understanding of what really is a spirit. How do you relate to a spirit? Every person we relate to has a body. And the Bible says for us not to know each other after the flesh, but to know each other after the spirit. And so what happens, though, is it's easier to know you that you're a female and you're a male and you're older, you're younger, you're white, you're black. It's easier to identify with that than with a spirit, because none of us have ever just been spirits without bodies with this awareness. And I'm just going to leave it there. I'm not trying to make anything up. I'm just saying, in my awareness, I've only ever had a body, okay? So it's hard and it's difficult, but he is a person, but he is a spirit, and he is present right here and right now. And if you want to experience more of the Holy Spirit, I would challenge you to begin to pray the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I know, yes, ma'am, I was getting ready to pray. You go right ahead. Wow. The twirlers over here are saying amen, amen, amen. Keep going. You cloud walker. That's what I was going to say. Cloud walking. Well, Amen. Okay, so. Let's piggyback on what she said. Two things. Number one, because we have an idea of what a father is and we have an idea of what a son was, and we watched what Jesus did while he was on the earth. But the Holy Spirit is not like us in those ways. And so the Holy Spirit is the place we get a little uncomfortable, because at least Jesus had arms and legs and walked and talked and had to sleep, you know, and all that stuff. The Holy Spirit is just altogether different, like the clouds and, you know, walking. And so one of the things that if you want a relationship with the Holy Spirit, talk to the Holy Spirit. You say, Holy Spirit, I want to know you. I want to feel your conviction in my life. I want to be aware when your presence is here. I want to know what grieves you. I want you to counsel me and teach me. And I want you to guide me. You're the great, you guide us and lead us. And I ask you that you make your voice very loud to us when we know that we're grieving you or we're quenching you or when we're following you and obeying you. And we just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would be our teacher and you would show us the things that attract you and show us the things that repel you, and that you would guide us beyond ourselves but guide us into your Spirit, and that you would sweep us up into yourself, and that we would dance with you in the heavenlies, and that we would leave the restraints of our earthly conditions and function in the supernatural with you in a dance. I just ask that you do that, Holy Spirit. Teach us in Jesus' name. Amen. See, pray to the Holy Spirit. It's okay to pray to the Holy Spirit. Number three, I'm going to stop here. He has a position. Now, let me finish with this. This is important. Acts 7, 55 and 56. This is talking about Stephen, who was full of the Holy Spirit. And it says, but he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and said, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. So what we see here is Stephen is on the earth and Stephen's being martyred. They're throwing stones at him. They're killing Stephen. And as Stephen is dying, suddenly the heavens open up. And Stephen sees from the earthly realm into the spiritual realm. He doesn't see forward into the future. He doesn't see backwards into the future. He sees real time into the present in what's happening in the heavenly realm. Now, that's New Testament. That's available for us, that we can see real time what's happening in the other dimension. It happens all throughout the Old Testament. It happens all throughout the New Testament. So Stephen, in this moment, sees more. It's just like Elisha's servant. When Elisha's servant goes outside, he's like, oh my gosh, there's a whole bunch of bad guys out here. Goes back in, gets the prophet, and the prophet says, oh Lord, open his eyes that he can see. And so he says, there's more for us than against us. And suddenly he sees these chariots of fire all around the enemy. The enemy that's got you surrounded is surrounded by the chariots of fire of the Lord, right? We just don't see far enough. We see the enemy. We just don't see the chariots of fire that far outnumber them. But here in the Old Testament, in just one moment, the Lord just pulls back the veil. Real time, Elisha's servant sees in the spirit realm, in the present, what is happening. And suddenly, he gets a whole new perspective. And I think if most of us had a vision of what was happening in the eternal realm, we probably wouldn't be as stressed out in this realm as we are right now. We see the enemy, we just don't see the troops that are surrounding the enemy. And so in this moment, Stephen being stoned, Stephen then looks, and suddenly the heavens are opened up, and he sees God the Father and Jesus sitting on his right hand. And Jesus is not seated. This is usually Jesus is seated, but this time Jesus is not seated. Jesus is standing. And Paul will write about Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. But where did Paul get that revelation? He was there overseeing Stephen as Stephen is saying the God is on the throne and there's Jesus standing at his right hand. So he is seeing God the Father. He is seeing Jesus, but he don't see the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit isn't seated next to God the Father. And the Holy Spirit isn't seated next to Jesus. He is full of the Holy Spirit. The scripture tells us. Stephen is full of the Holy Spirit. And he looks probably through the Holy Spirit and sees God the Father and Jesus not seated, because there's no way Jesus could be seated when one of his martyrs is being killed. He stands in approval. He stands with empathy and compassion and love. Jesus stands with God the Father, God the Son. But the Holy Spirit's not up there. The Holy Spirit's here. And so, remember when Jesus said, it's better for you that I go away. The disciples were like, what are you talking about? We was fishing. We was broke fishermen. You came along. You told us that you were the Son of God. You told us that God's going to pour out His Spirit on the earth. You told us that revival's coming. You told us that God's going to reclaim everything to Adam. Well, you're the only hope. We sold everything to follow you. What do you mean our life's going to be better if you leave? He said, if I leave, I will send the Comforter, I'll send the Helper to come be with you. And it's better for you if one God in flesh, limited by time and space, goes away, so that another, the other God, Holy Spirit, that is not limited by time and space and flesh, comes, and then he says, and you will be the temple of the Holy Spirit. Wow. So if you want to find the Holy Spirit, you don't look to heaven. You look down here somewhere. What a God. What a God that would send his son to live in the flesh of one man, only to have that one man die for our sins, go to the pit of hell, then come and be resurrected from the dead and ascend 40 days later, so that the Spirit of God could dwell in all men, the first fruit among many brethren. And so now the Holy Spirit's to live inside of us. So now, for the first time, now listen, I don't think you understand just that what we're talking about. In the Old Testament, we were talking about a God that was far away. God the Father, Yahweh, that lives in heaven, that's far away, that can't even live with his people because he's going to kill them all because they're such rebels. To New Testament, God the Son has come and he lives near us. He lives by us. He lives with us. To now, God the Holy Spirit who lives in us, who fills us, who delights to be in us. It's a whole different thing for the Holy Spirit because he lives inside of us. What a privilege. David looked at your day and he envied the relationship. All he could do was put up a tabernacle in his backyard, break all the rules because he knew that God wanted to be with him, but yet God didn't fill him. And we have that. And then we're not careful to grieve and quench the Holy Spirit. And we have such a privilege, but such a responsibility. And so over the next 13 weeks, we're going to not just talk about the Holy Spirit, but experience the Holy Spirit, practice with the Holy Spirit. But as a foundation, what? What? He's calling you out. Good. You go right ahead. Okay, I was sort of looking at my notes and sort of listening to you, hoping that Chip or Mike Dieter was going to answer you. But since they did not, you said that God is a God of covenant and Jesus was the mediator of the new covenant. I'm going to have to think about that. I have a word that just came to my mind, but I don't think I should say it publicly. So I'm going to have to think about it a little bit. Because in my younger days, I would have just said the word. But now I'm trying to think it through a little bit. Michael, do you have any thoughts on that? Okay. So where Abraham could not even offer covenant to God because he didn't have the power to accomplish that. I'm just filling in his words. Where God the Father through the Holy Spirit can offer his son to make the covenant. Now that we've received the son as our forgiveness of our sins and he's the firstborn among many brethren and now God's our father and has adopted us as his children. It's the same Holy Spirit that allows us to walk in covenant with one another. Would that get close? What were we going to say? Okay, you all whisper over there. I didn't know which conversation we were going to have. So it's always fun when you... So just let's take a few minutes. I'm going to stop right there. I'm going to leave some meat on the bones for Cindy to talk about the Holy Spirit.